Diggin', dig it.
Episode of The Book Isn't Necessarily Better, a podcast hosted by the Community Library Network. I'm your host, Michaela.
And I'm your host, Roxanne.
Today we're talking about a book and film very near and dear to my childhood heart.
Me too!
Right? We're talking about Holes by Lewis Sacker. So, Roxanne, do you want to tell us a little bit about Lewis?
Yes, so Lewis Sacker, and until a couple days ago, I'd been calling him Lewis Sacher my entire life. Mm-hmm. It is Sacker rhymes with cracker. I found an audio clip of him saying that.
Straight from the horse's mouth.
Yes. So Lewis Sacker was born in East Meadow, New York on March 20th in 1954. He's still alive. And he moved from New York to Tustin, California in the third grade. If you look up photos of him, he looks like a very friendly guy.
Yeah.
Have you seen pictures?
I have.
He looks very sweet.
He reminds me a little bit of Gary Paulson.
Yes, he does. So, Lewis, he went to Berkeley and he majored in economics. And when he was in college to support himself, he worked as a Fuller Brush Man, which is basically a door-to-door salesman selling, like, cleaning supplies.
Oh.
Fun fact, Bill Callenborn, my dad, was a Fuller Brush Man. He always talked about his days as a salesman. And when he was in college, he also worked for credit at an elementary school as like a yard monitor.
Yeah, I think a supervisor for younger grades, like second, third grade, and a yard supervisor.
And that's where he got the name Lewis the Yard Teacher, which, of course, he would use in his first book, Sideways Stories from Wayside School, which came out in 1976, wow. Which is a real delight to read.
Yeah. Have you read all the Wayside School books?
I have.
Me too.
It's a wonderful series. and there's a character in there that he names after himself.
Yep.
He also wrote the book, There's a Boy in the Girl's Bathroom, which I mentioned because the guidance counselor in that is
kind of loosely based on?
Yeah, modeled after his wife, Carla. They got married in 1985, and they live in Austin, Texas now. And he has a daughter born in 1987, which I like that she's my age.
She could be your pal.
And she's a zookeeper.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, which I find delightful.
That's like a dream job.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And Lewis says he writes every morning for 2 hours a day, but he never talks about his books with anyone, not his family, not even really his editors, until he's completely finished.
Wow.
And his big hobby in life is that he loves to play bridge.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What I love is that in all of the interviews that I've read with him, I totally believe what he says about himself. He says that he doesn't do biographical characters. Like, he doesn't put himself into really any of his characters, aside from Lewis the Yard Teacher.
Okay, I was like, well, except for the glaring one.
Right. He uses the name, but he says that guy is nothing like him. And he says that this is because he's too boring of a human to, like, have anything based on him. And it's funny because I actually read some interviews he did with Scholastic around the time that Holes and then the subsequent Small Steps came out. And he's actually, I'm sorry, Lewis, you seem like kind of a boring dude.
Really?
Yeah. He gives like super like one word answers, or like just he's really short and clipped. And anyway, I just thought that was very interesting.
Wow. Well, I would love to meet him someday. Lewis, call us.
We're waiting.
Did you know, Michaela, that some of his influences and favorite authors include Kurt Vonnegut, but also Margaret Atwood, your favorite.
My favorite. I knew about Kurt Vonnegut. I am thrilled that we have the same, one of the same literary heroes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Shout out to Peggy.
So Lewis has written a lot of wonderful books that had a big influence on my childhood and a lot of other people's childhoods. But today we're focusing on 1998's Holes.
Arguably the best of all of his books.
And absolutely one of my favorite books, hands down.
Oh, yeah. I have the Scholastic imprint that I bought at one of the Scholastic book fairs in school when I was in elementary school. I love this book.
This is truly a book that can be enjoyed by any age.
Yeah.
This is a 1 to 100 kind of book.
Oh, yeah.
It's just a good story.
It is. I read it again about a week ago and still love it.
wonderful.
One of the few childhood books I retain now.
So, Michaela, why don't you give us a synopsis of Holes?
Okay. The plot of Holes. And I don't feel bad telling you this because this book has been out for 23 years. If you haven't read it already, you're going to now, but I don't feel bad spoiling.
So, I think the spoiler rule is 15 years.
Yep. So we're well past it, people. Get with it. So Stanley Yelnats IV. And yes, Yelnats is Stanley spelled backwards. Stanley Yelnats IV has the worst luck of any kid who's ever existed. Theoretically, I mean, Lewis Sacker says he has really bad luck, but like the worst that happens to him is he's kind of poor and he's overweight.
Yeah, I mean, I'd say a lot of the other kids that he will meet seem to have much worse luck in abusive households.
Yes, much, much, much worse time. But this is like the light version of having really bad luck in kind of a comedic way. So his family, ever since his no good, dirty, rotten, pig-stealing great-great-grandfather reneged on a deal and failed to carry a fortune teller, Madame Zeroni, up the mountain to drink from this magical stream.
In the country of Latvia.
Yes.
That's where his ancestors come from.
Yes. Elja Yelnats. That's a real, say that five times fast. I can. Ever since his no good, dirty, rotten, pig-stealing great-great-grandfather failed to do this, the whole family has been cursed with bad luck. So his great-grandfather, Stanley Yelnats, the first, was traveling across Green Lake in Texas and was actually set upon by the bandit Kissin' Kate Barlow and stole his entire fortune, which has left the family in generational poverty. And his dad is now working on a solution to stinky feet. He's an inventor, and this is the route he's chosen to go, curing the world's athlete's foot problems. Stanley, one day, is walking around and a pair of shoes hits him out of nowhere, is sent to Camp Green Lake Juvenile Detention Facility for supposedly stealing the shoes of Clyde Sweetfeet Livingston, who is a famous athlete from their area. And supposedly he stole the shoes. He is sent to this juvenile boys camp where every day they are made to go out and dig a 5-foot by 5-foot hole.
As long as they're shovel. So yes. They have to lay it down and be able to stand it up and be 5 feet.
Yep. And supposedly this is to build character.
Because they say you take a bad boy, you make him dig holes every day, and then you get a good boy.
You get a good boy out of it. Yes. Stanley starts to suspect that instead of doing it to build character, they are actually looking for something in this dry lake bed. So he befriends some of the other campers, including Zero. They all have nicknames. So Zero is Hector's nickname. Stanley's is Caveman. Because he finds a fossil.
Yeah, I think it's also just because he's kind of a big kid.
Yes, also that. Anyway, makes some friends at camp, kind of uncovers a mystery. I won't tell you what it is, even though I could, because we're past the spoiler date. But I'll leave it to you to read.
All right. So a little bit more about the book. It won the 1998 U.S. National Book Award for YA Lit. Although there is a lot of controversy if it's more a kid's book or a YA book.
Right.
But again, I think it's an everybody book.
I do too. But I think if I had to pick, I would say it's a juvenile book, not a YA.
What I really appreciate about this book is that it talks to you the way that your favorite teacher talks to you in elementary school, like an adult.
Yeah, absolutely.
It deals with some intense themes.
Very intense.
There's racism. There's a lynching.
Yeah.
Not a physical lynching.
But
a man gets shot.
Right. And I might read you my quote now because it kind of goes along with this. I was actually surprised rereading this at how sophisticated some of the plot was.
It really is.
It really is. And stuff that I really didn't remember as a kid. So there is a woman in this town of Green Lake, a white woman who has fallen in love with a black man.
And this is told in flashbacks from the 1800s.
Yes, late 1800s, I think 1880s.
Yeah.
So at this time, miscegenation is against the law, which is interracial marrying. And so someone sees them kissing and says, God will punish you, sends the lynch mob after them. And the quote from one of the next pages is, I just stopped dead in my tracks and read it about 5 times. So this is a really great quote. These are the facts. The Walker boat smashed into Sam's boat. Sam was shot and killed in the water. Kathleen Barlow was rescued against her wishes. When they returned to the shore, she saw Mary Lou's body lying on the ground. The donkey had been shot in the head. That all happened 110 years ago. Since then, not one drop of rain has fallen on Green Lake. You make the decision. Whom did God punish?
That puts a knot in my stomach. And
yeah. I mean, I was reading a kid's book. Brings me to
tears.
Yeah, and I just stopped at that and was like, wow, I can't believe I read this as like a, I don't know, probably 8 or 9 year old kid.
Mm-hmm.
That's a lot more sophisticated than a lot of the things I was reading as an 8 or 9 year old kid.
Yeah. I like that the book trusts kids to handle that.
Yeah. And it's not, I don't think, represented in any sort of, like, depth or anything. I think it's just represented as facts. These two people love each other and are separated, and that is what happened.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a really great way to treat that for kids. It did also win, while we were talking about awards, the 1999 Newbery Medal for the year's most distinguished contribution to American literature for children.
Mm-hmm.
Highly respected and recommended book.
Yeah, it's great.
Mm-hmm.
And just to give a little bit more of the plot, so that Catherine that was rescued against her will is this very sweet school teacher who falls in love with the onion picker, mm-hmm. cellar man who comes by, who's black. And after she's rescued against her will, she, from the trauma, becomes a murderer. Mm-hmm. She goes and murders the sheriff and leaves a kiss on his cheek that becomes her calling card with her lipstick. And then she goes on to become a bandit.
Yeah.
And she becomes Kissing Kate Barlow, who then robs Stanley Yelnats.
Great-grandfather.
Yes.
The first Stanley. And that's another really great sort of trusting children with material is she kisses them as her calling card because the sheriff says, you kissed him, the onion picker, why won't you kiss me? If you do that, I will, like, I'll call off the mob. And she's like, no thank you, sir. Which I just think is another really great character move.
Yeah. The way that there's all these puzzle pieces that fit together is so clever.
Mm-hmm.
Would you call this book a mystery?
I wouldn't call it a mystery, but I do think there's kind of a mysterious element to it.
You get the same satisfaction at the end as when you read a mystery novel.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it wraps up loose ends very nicely.
Mm-hmm. And it took Lewis Sacker 18 months to write this. It usually takes him about 3 or 4 months to write a book.
Right.
And it was his 18th book. And the reason he said it, and that the reason it's so different than his other books, is because he realized he wrote a lot of books about kids in school. And he thought, well, I still want to do a kid's book, but I'm really tired of writing about kids going through normal problems at school. So he decided, I'm going to base it on a juvenile detention facility. And what's more, he said it in Texas because his family had just moved there from California, basically from the Bay Area. So from, like, kind of wet and misty to just dry and
arid.
Arid is the perfect word.
The character of the lawyer is also loosely based on his wife.
Oh, great. Yeah. Well, the warden in the book is this terrifying woman who owns the land that Camp Green Lake is on, and she's looking for, should we just spoil it?
Yeah, let's just spoil it.
So she's looking for the money that she knows, she
assumes
that Kissing Kate Barlow, like her pirate's treasure, basically.
Yeah. There's pirate's booty in that lake, for sure.
Yeah, essentially. So her great-great-grandfather had been Trout Walker, who owned the town of Green Lake. And after Kate Barlow died, he spent all his time digging holes looking for this treasure.
It's also probably important to note that he is a rich white man who owns the town and makes some advances toward Kate and is turned down. And then is very upset that she has turned him down for Sam the onion picker.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that's a lot of the catalyst for Sam getting lynched.
Yeah. This book does have a follow-up novel that I haven't read. Have you?
No, I haven't.
Okay. Called Small Steps, which came out in 2006, so 8 years after the original. It follows some of the other campers at the Camp Green Lake, Armpit and X-Ray, who... Again, if we're talking about who has really bad luck at this juvenile detention facility, those guys definitely do. X-Ray is, like, basically blind. Can't see a whole lot.
Coke bottle glasses.
Yeah. You don't really know what he's there for, but you kind of get the idea that he's had some trauma in his past. And Armpit is another bigger kid who's there. And at the end, he's like, Stanley, I just want you, when you get out of here, to like tell my mom I'm sorry. So, again, has some sort of trauma in his past. And these are all like youngish kids. They're not really more than maybe 14 or 15.
Yeah, they're young teenagers.
Yeah. And then Hector Zeroni, who all the kids call Zero, he can't read, but that doesn't mean he's not smart. He's actually extremely good at math, and asks Stanley to teach him how to read. But literally everybody at the camp calls him Zero, and just because he doesn't like to answer their questions, pretends that he's stupid, including the counselor, who insists on calling all of the other boys by the names that society will recognize them by.
Mr. Pendansky.
Yes. And he calls all the kids by their first names. So he always calls them Stanley, Rex, Alan. I can't remember the other kids' names, except for Zero. He also calls him Zero.
And he is an absolute sadist
to
this kid.
Oh, yes.
I mean, I'm sure we've all been in classroom situations where you can tell the teacher hates
that one kid.
And will go out of their way to be cruel.
Yeah, that's definitely Mr. Pendansky.
Besides Mr. Pendansky, the other counselor is named Mr. Sir. So it's sort of good cop, bad cop. Mr. Pendansky.
Yeah, kind of like bad cop, worse cop.
Well, finishing my thought, okay, Mr. Pendansky comes off as a more reasonable one, but then you see through his treatment of Zero that he's an everyday sadist.
And what is an everyday sadist? What's an everyday sadist?
It's something we learn in our training.
Yes, it is.
You realize that some people just exist in the world to be cruel to those who have less power than them. So Mr. Pendansky seems like he could be the good cop, but you see through his actions, and later in the book, he's pretty much okay with like just shooting Hector and Stanley.
Forgot about that one.
Because Hector and Stanley find this treasure after a series of misadventures, and
he's basically okay with shooting them.
Yeah, he's basically okay with killing the kids. And then there's Mr. Sir, who is the rougher one. He's still a jerk, but he's still a sadist. They're all sadists.
Yeah. I actually feel like he's less of a jerk than Mr. Pendansky, but he is definitely played off as the villain, at least until the warden finally steps in. She's kind of some mystical creature that like exists in her own world, and you don't really see her until much later in the book. And I think that the first glimpse you get of her is she has this rattlesnake-infused nail polish. And basically scratches Mr. Sir's face with rattlesnake poison. And then you find out that she is much, much worse than the rest of them.
And more powerful.
Yes, definitely more powerful.
Yeah, so she is the descendant of the evil trout walker. So she had to grow up digging holes looking for this treasure.
Her whole life.
Yep. And then she started a camp. Now, this might be totally beside the point, but has it ever crossed your mind, like, why didn't she hire bulldozers or, like, diggers?
Yeah, because she didn't have enough money to do that at the outset, I would assume.
You think so?
Yeah.
It can't be that. I mean, if you have to build barracks and stuff, why can't you just rent?
Because she got the state to pay for everything.
Okay.
By making it like a state facility where she is doing good work of transforming boys, she gets other people to pay for it. It's a scam, right? So, yeah.
Okay, I'm really glad you cleared that up.
Okay.
Because I could not figure out why you wouldn't just hire mechanical.
I'm with you.
Let's get like a 4-year-old boy to ask because they seem to know all the.
They always know the
trucks. They always know.
Yes.
So there is one more book related to this that I didn't know existed until yesterday. Stanley Yelnat's Survival Guide to Camp Green Lake, which looks like a lot of fun. It's only about 96 pages.
Right.
And it's sort of a companion.
Yeah, it's a movie tie-in.
The movie tie-in, okay.
Yeah, which I don't love about it. It was released to coincide with the movie's release to be sort of like a promotional material.
So the book was written in 1998, and the movie came out in 2003.
Right.
I'd really like to get my hands on that survival guide, because it looked fun.
We'll see if we can find it through Interlibrary Love.
Ooh.
Ooh.
Yeah, let's talk about the movie.
Okay.
So, movie comes out in 2003. One of my favorite memories from middle school, I would have been in 7th grade, 8th grade. is that they rented out a theater and they took like all of the seventh grade to go see this movie.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, it was really delightful. yeah, it's like one of my favorite middle school memories because, you know, middle school is a hard time.
It is a you could not pay me enough to go back to middle school.
No, but that was a really wonderful memory I have of my childhood.
Oh, that's sweet.
Now, the movie is star-studded. Mm-hmm. First off, Eartha Kitt is in it as right? Madame Zeroni.
Yeah.
And Shia LaBeouf, who is now very troubled and has been dropped by his agency
but
at the current moment.
But also making some really good films lately.
Yeah?
So Peanut Butter Falcon I haven't seen yet, but it's high on my list, my to-watch list.
Well, he very recently got canceled.
Oh.
Like, recently.
Oh.
He
and
got
Honey
sued
Boy
by...
was the other good one. So.
What was the other good one?
Honey Boy.
Honey Boy.
And I thought that movie was amazing. He wrote and directed and starred in it.
Wow.
Yeah.
I mean, he is immensely talented, mm-hmm. and he also is very troubled.
He's also, if you have not seen the actual Cannibal Shia LaBeouf YouTube video, you must watch it.
I haven't.
Right now.
Okay.
Okay.
Safe for work or not?
No.
Oh, okay. So everyone...
I don't think so.
not safe for work.
No. But super funny.
So this is Shia LaBeouf's first movie. Of course, he got famous being in Even Stevens.
I actually found out because I also thought it was his first movie.
Yeah, because at the end it says
introducing Shia LaBeouf. He actually, in 1998, had a very small part in a movie called The Christmas Path. But I thought that that was very weird that they still chose to introduce him. I mean, it's his first major role in a movie.
Yeah, it's true.
But I thought that was strange.
Hmm. See, who else did it? So, Tim Blake Nelson plays Mr. Pendansky, who is in Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? And he says my favorite line from all movie history, which is, we thought you was a toad.
Right.
That's my favorite. Yeah. Dule Hill plays Sam, the onion picker, and I've been in love with him since I saw this movie in 2003.
Okay.
Patricia Arquette. Wait. Oh, and Dule Hill is from Psych.
Psych. Okay, I was going to say, are you a big Psych fan?
I like Psych.
Okay.
And I like him in it.
Okay. I was like, I'm not a huge fan, but I do like him in that show.
Yeah. And I think he's great in this movie. And Patricia Arquette plays Catherine Barlow, who goes on to be kissing Kate Barlow. And I think she does an amazing job.
I was actually very surprised by how much I liked her in this movie.
Do you not usually like her?
No.
Well, everyone likes her. what is there to dislike?
I'm not really sure. I think my impression... And okay. This is maybe a totally mistaken impression, is that besides this movie and Boyhood, mm-hmm. which I did really enjoy, mm-hmm. she always plays kind of like trashy characters.
I know, isn't it great?
But I don't know that I love her. Anyway, it's my own thing. That's bias on my part.
Yeah, well, I love her, and I think she's great. And I have to say that the scenes that they have together, they have such wonderful chemistry, I think are some of the most romantic scenes in movies I can think of. Like,
definitely
you know, I don't get emotional watching movies, but
right.
I almost cry. Both happy tears and sad tears. Because a very romantic thing. And it's very Princess Bride-like, As You Wish.
Yeah, absolutely.
They fall in love because... She trades him peaches for fixing up the classroom. And
she keeps finding problems.
Yeah. So she keeps finding things for him to fix. And he always says, I can fix that. Mm-hmm. And then one day, he comes in and she's crying. And she says, I have a broken heart.
Yeah.
And he says, I can fix that. And it's so romantic.
It is very sweet.
It gets me.
Mm-hmm. Verklempt.
I'm so verklempt. So some of the most romantic scenes. I love them. I'm gushing.
That's funny. There's also Sigourney Weaver.
Oh, she's right? Amazing.
Plays the warden.
And it's perfect because the warden is supposed to be a ginger, which I can say because Michaela and I are both gingers.
We are. Kind of.
With freckles. I also have freckles. So she's supposed to be like a freckly ginger.
Right.
And she plays... She's so scary.
She's very... I'm quaking in my boots.
In your turquoise-studded boots.
Yep.
Who else? Oh, and John Voight. Mr. Sir is played by John Voight. Who... Did you know that he is Angelina Jolie's dad?
I did. He's also...
He is.
My favorite part of the movie Zoolander.
What part is he?
He plays Zoolander's dad.
Oh, you're right. In the coal mine.
Yes.
I think I got the black lung pop.
Yep, exactly. So,
so good.
Maybe not the thing he wants to be remembered for, but definitely the thing that sticks in my mind. Poor John.
You know who's a wonderful character actor in this? Stanley's mom, who...
Oh, she's my least favorite part of this movie.
I love her.
Okay, that...
Why do you... Why?
Because she's so over the top.
I think she's delightful. Because she's a talented character actor. Her name is Siobhan Fallon Hogan?
Yes.
Do you know who she's played?
No.
It was bothering me. She plays the bus driver from Forrest Gump, Dolores.
Oh.
You know when he's little?
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, are you going to get on the bus? And then he sees her when she's old.
Okay.
It's that character actor. Okay. And I think she's delightful.
Wow.
And... even more delightful, his dad is played by Henry Winkler.
Yes.
AKA
he is delightful.
The Fonz. And apparently he is the nicest man in Hollywood.
Oh. That's great.
I love him.
I think he's fun in this movie.
I'm just gushing today. I love this movie. Gushy. I love the cast.
I think that the memory of this movie that sticks with me is in the aftermath of this movie, so I probably was in middle school when this happened, I came to this very library and checked out the Holes soundtrack that we had at the time, and then I ripped it. Please don't tell my boss. I ripped that CD and listened to that CD on repeat for a very long time.
It's a great soundtrack.
It's a pretty good soundtrack.
The styles are all over the place.
The mishmash.
Yeah, like there's some really wonderful... I guess blues, you'd say.
Yeah, there's like a great blues song in there.
Yeah, and then it will kind of randomly have like a more contemporary, like 2003 song in there. So
there's some like country-esque songs. There's some like rap-esque songs.
Yeah.
Except, I mean, they're like clean versions of stuff.
Well, I mean, there is the famous song, the main song, called Dig It.
Yeah.
And it goes, digging, dig it. And then Shia LaBeouf raps in it, which is hilarious.
It's very bad. I think all the kids do part of the rap.
I think they do.
Yeah. There's that one. And then there's also a song that comes from the book itself where they say, there's a couple different versions. I think the song version says, if only the woodpecker sighs, the bark on this tree was as soft as the skies. And it talks about a wolf crying to the moon. And it ends, if only. And that song actually is really cool in the soundtrack and in the movie. So that was a big influence on my 12-year-old psyche.
And that goes along with the sort of finale of the movie. So Hector, who's Zero, and Stanley end up in the desert, and they're trying to survive long enough to get back to camp and steal water and...
That's basically their only plan is, water, then survive.
Yeah, they don't really know what they're going to do after that.
Right. It's as far as the plan goes.
But at one point, he has to carry Hector up the mountain, and then he is singing this lullaby sort of to himself to self-soothe. But he doesn't realize that Hector is a great-great-great-grandson of Madame Zeroni. And so...
Didn't see that coming.
The curse that was placed on Stanley's family because he never carried Madame Zeroni up the hill is unbroken because he carried his great-great-great-grandson up the mountain and sang the lullaby to him.
That is one thing we didn't mention as we were talking about the book. I am actually kind of bummed that some of that stuff is telegraphed so heavily. I remember it being a little bit more... Like, when I was a kid reading this, I was like, oh, he's her great, great, great. But his name is literally Zero, and her last name is Zeroni.
Yeah, and in the movie, it's a kid's movie, but the book trusts you as a kid to figure it out.
Right.
In the movie, you see Eartha Kitt's face, like, over when he's singing.
Yeah.
Like, saying, get it?
Yeah.
Get it? The curse is...
It's very in your face.
Broken.
Yeah. Speaking of it being a kid's movie, I mean, it was nominated for a lot of awards. Hmm. It only won Best Family Film from the Las Vegas Film Critics Society. So
they would know.
They would know. But it was nominated for an MTV Breakthrough Male Performance for Shia LaBeouf.
He's great in it.
He is really great in it. It was also nominated for Best Performance in a Feature Film, both for leading and supporting actors, for Shia LaBeouf as the lead, Cleo Thomas, who plays Zero, as a supporting, and also, I can't say this kid's name right, Nola Politique. I don't know. Politic, maybe? He plays the Carson Twitch.
For Twitch?
Yeah, like, seriously. That he's kid in comes it for 5 seconds at the end.
Literally.
Like, I love stealing cars! And then Stanley steals a car.
Yeah.
But he also, yeah, was nominated. And it also got nominated for Best Family Feature Film.
I smell nepotism for that Twitch thing.
Right? I'm kind of very confused by that. Because Shia LaBeouf is legitimately great in this movie.
Yes.
And Cleo Thomas is legitimately great in this movie. That other kid is in there. He's a footnote to this movie. I don't understand why he's nominated.
Interesting.
Anyway, very fascinating. I thought that was very weird.
So, you know who makes a cameo in this?
I do.
Lewis Sacker.
Wow.
And he plays Mr. Collingwood in one of the flashback scenes. So Sam is selling his onions. And he also makes these onion tonics.
Right.
He says, like, it can cure anything or you'll live forever. Kind of a patent medicine.
Yeah. Snake oil.
Basically. But
but it does actually work.
Yep. So Mr. Collingwood is one of the customers, and he takes his hat off and he's bald. He's like, you rub it on your head and and you'll grow hair.
I think he actually says it to the wife. It's very like,
yeah.
Oh, Mrs. Collingwood, rub this on your husband's head. He'll regain the vigor of his youth.
Yeah, for sure. Less.
Yeah.
And Lewis Sacker wrote the screenplay.
Yeah.
Which makes sense because the movie and the book are really similar.
Yeah, there is almost no difference, honestly, between the two.
Yeah, because it's such an amazing book.
Right.
That I think it really naturally went into a movie.
Right.
Especially with the flashbacks. I mean,
I think that that's a really great narrative structure for this. Lewis Sacker was actually very worried about writing the book in multiple timelines. He thought that it might be too confusing for kids, but I'm glad he decided to trust his instincts. Because the flashbacks definitely inform what's happening in the present and make that a lot more relatable for the characters.
It's just wonderful.
It is.
This movie made $71.4 million globally.
Wow.
So
okay.
We're not the only people who think it's great.
Mm-hmm.
I want to talk about filming a little bit.
Sure.
So they had all the diggers, the teen boys, come to the set a week early before they began shooting.
Mm-hmm.
And the head stuntman made them dig holes and do other exercise to toughen them up.
Oh.
But then John Voight was there and he stayed in character to terrify them.
Great.
So that they'd be scared of him and it'd be more natural.
Wow. That's a very John Voight thing to do.
Mm-hmm. But Shia LaBeouf wasn't there because he was still working on Even Stevens, the TV show. So he really was the new kid like he is in the movie.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
And similar to our conversation about Ready Player One, in the book, Holes, Stanley is an overweight kid.
Extremely overweight. He gets bullied.
Yeah, he has a really hard social life.
Right.
And then what I appreciate in the book is that it's not like, and not all his problems are solved at the end because he's been working out.
Right.
And he's not overweight anymore.
Right.
He even makes a point to like say like, we don't need to even tell you how Stanley evolved.
In fact, he says, the other holes you can fill in for yourself.
Yeah.
Which is kitschy, and I love it.
But, yeah, I like that. But again, like Ready Player One, it's nice to have representation in the book of overweight people. But in the movie, you get skinny Shia LaBeouf.
Mm-hmm.
And they said the reason they didn't make him overweight in the movie is because they didn't feel like they could ask teenage Shia LaBeouf to gain 100 pounds. And then because they film scenes out of sequence, it was too hard. And they didn't want to put him in a fat suit.
Right. I understand that.
Yeah, I understand that. It would be nice.
It would be.
if he had been overweight, like in the book, and make that part of his journey.
Right. For sure. I do think it's funny that you said all of his problems are not magically fixed by him, like, working out. Because on the other hand, all of his problems are magically fixed by him undoing this decades-long curse on his family.
Yeah, that's true. So by undoing the curse, his father finds his solution to the, like, de-stinking, sneaker de-stinking.
De-stinkifying.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they name it Sploosh after these, like,
spiced peaches.
Spiced peaches that Catherine Barlow had made over 110 years ago.
And they lived, but they don't get drunk on them, which I find surprising.
I was very curious. They find these out in the desert, and that's what they live on until they get to this sort of oasis with onions and water. But I was like, okay, that's fermented fruit.
It's definitely fermented fruit. That's fermented for 100 years. It's alcohol.
It should either be alcohol or vinegar by that point,
yeah,
right?
Okay, yeah. Or vinegar. Didn't think about that.
And he's like, yeah, it's just kind of warm and sweet.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Baloney.
That's unrealistic.
I call baloney on that one.
Here's a question for you.
Mm-hmm.
Is this a fairy tale?
I think it has a lot of fairy tale elements. It definitely has a protagonist who has to go on some sort of a quest in order to kind of reverse his destiny.
Mm-hmm. Well, and magical elements.
It does have magical elements. The fortune teller at the beginning, Madame Zeroni, the fortune teller, but also just the fact of him completing the quest by carrying this kid up a mountain and singing a song to him and drinking from a magic stream mm-hmm. seems very, very fairy tale. Do you not agree with that?
No, I think it is a fairy tale. It just sort of dawned on me.
I wanted to hear your thoughts on it. It's kind of a modern fairy tale. I would classify it that way, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of it does feel like it could happen, although the coincidences are very tidy.
Sure. The one thing that I have a problem calling it a fairy tale is there's not really like that sort of guidance character who comes in and, you know, says this is the way forward, which
right.
is usually there is one in some sort of fairy tale, unless you count that as being Madame Zeroni kind of in flashback.
Right, like his great-great-great-grandfather was given the quest.
Right.
And then Stanley fulfills it.
But I'd still buy this as a fairy tale, mm-hmm. for sure. It even has shoes. Lots and lots
of...
Right?
Sort of magic shoes.
Sort of magic shoes. Mm-hmm.
Yes, because at the end of the book, of course, so not only did his dad invent the
sploosh,
which he realizes is a mixture of onions and peaches.
Right. That cures foot odor.
Mm-hmm. But he also finds the treasure left behind by Kate Barlow and becomes a millionaire.
And Zero finds his mom, who has been, again, if we're talking about people who have it worse than Stanley, Zero's mom literally disappears one day, and he's living in a park until he becomes a ward of the state and doesn't know what happened to his mom, and finds his mom at the end.
Yeah, because he was able to hire private investigators.
Right, because what was in the treasure case... millions of dollars worth of, like, promissory notes.
Yep. In the movie, they say it's, like, AT&T stock, which makes sense.
Yeah.
It's from 1905.
Yeah.
There's one more thing about the movie I want to tell you.
Okay.
This might be my favorite. So, when they were doing the movie, John Voight, Sigourney Weaver, and Tim...
Blake Nelson
wanted to figure out how they all met, all the characters, and so they came up with this backstory that didn't make it into the movie. Did you hear about this?
I haven't. Tell me.
They came up with this wonderful backstory with Lewis Sacker. Lewis Sacker sat down and wrote a 3-page story about how Mr. Sir and Mr. Pinansky met, which is apparently that Mr. Sir was, quote, running a fencing operation, and I had to look that up because I'm a square. Fencing in crime is like selling stolen goods.
Yep.
That Mr. Sir was running a fencing operation out of the back of a strip club in Albuquerque.
Wow.
And Mr. Pendansky knew him from there and would occasionally forge phony documents of authentication.
Oh.
And this is all quote. Of course, none of that made it into the script, but presumably it helped the actors know who they were.
They do call Mr. Sir out when the feds sort of come in and take over for being part of a fencing operation.
Yep. And that he was living under an alias working at the camp.
Mm-hmm. And that Mr. Pendansky is not a real doctor.
Yeah, in the book he's not a doctor.
He's not.
In the movie, he's Dr. Pendansky, but right. I like that.
It's a nice extra little cherry on top.
Yeah, it's like we have these celebrities. Let's let's add a little more.
I was thinking of it more for, like, the kids being like, ha-ha, we've bested you.
Yeah, it's always great in, you know, kids' books when they get taken away by
revenge
police.
On adults.
Yeah.
The ogres of the story, if you will.
Well, this has essentially been a gushing session.
Yeah.
Wonderful movie, wonderful book.
Yeah.
Do yourself a favor.
Read it. Read it with your kids. Read it for yourself.
You can find all of these things at the Community Library Network. I have been your podcast host, Roxanne.
And your co-host, Michaela.
And we will...
talk at you later.
Ooh, that's an intense word to say.
Yes, and we've said it a lot.
Yeah. I'm an indoor kid. I don't know.
Right. My grandpa's had big trucks, and my uncle owns a construction company, and I still couldn't tell you what they are.
The scoopy things.
Yep. The ones with the scoops.
My mouth dried up from laughing.